Our first speaker for this today is Mario Natale, and he's going to give a talk on his software called Murmur. And he graduated from University of, Bologna in January 1978 with full marks in electronic engineering, discussing an experimental thesis on positional detection of electromagnetic radiation. He started his initial career in semiconductor field with Texas Instruments Group. In 2000, he began a cooperation with the UTAC Electronic Semiconductor Services Company in Singapore, dealing with technical marketing and holding positions of president and CEO of UTAC Europe. In parallel, he has also been a very active ham radio operator with the call sign I0NAA. And in 2015, he installed a 5-meter parabolic antenna that is now fully dedicated to moonbound CME to radio astronomy activity focused on the detection of pulsars. Mario is often invited speaker to talk with radio and technology in conferences and seminars, also producing free software to support amateur radio and amateur radio astronomy community. And just for my personal thing, I've been competing with Mario on pulsar detections, but I've been using his software to do that. So I don't know if that's cheating or not, but I really appreciate all the Murmur. I've been using Murmur for a couple of years now, and I really super software. So I recommend anybody who wants to do pulsars, look at the stuff that he's going to present today. Very excellent engineer and scientist. Okay, Mario, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Rich. Let me start to share the screen. Let's see. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. It's okay?
There you go. Looks good.
Okay. Hey, thank you. Thank you, Rich, for the introduction. And thank you to Sarah for inviting me. It's a real pleasure and an honor to be invited from your organization. And tonight, actually, I should say today for you, but here is 7 o'clock p.m. I'm located in Italy right now. I'm going to share with you the genesis, how this program was started, and I will discuss with you and possibly explain the many features that this program got. How this program is named, Murmur, as Rich was saying before, and what is able to do. Let me start from the beginning. I'm a ham radio operator, and my call sign is I0NAA. And at the very beginning, and I started to be ham radio operator in 1970, so many, many years ago. I started with AM, by the way. I was an avid HF guy, but then my interest started slowly to shift toward the more complicated things, toward higher frequency and toward microwaves and toward radio astronomy too. So finally, when I retired and I was managing director, now I'm just a kitchen director because it's just my boss is my wife right now. I started thinking to put up something serious. And then in my background, you can see my antenna. It's 5-meter dish. I start operation in 2015 on 23 centimeters EME. I am very active in 23 centimeters EME. I'm present in different contests. However, after the installation of this dish, actually a problem was very, very clear that you can make EME QSO only when the moon is visible. This is obvious. But then when I realized this, after spending a very long time in installing this beast, this is about 1 ton. It's the people that got a big dish, of course, not like Wolfgang one, but you know, 5-7 meter dish or 10 meter dish can understand the difficulty in handling this. I said, well, the utilization of this asset is too low. I was a semiconductor guy, so the utilization of asset was key factor for us. And so he said, what can I do when the moon is not there? And I decided to resume a passion that my father Alberto transmitted to me when we were watching together the sky when I was a kid. And I said, well, it's astronomy, or maybe it's even better, it's radio astronomy. But I was lucky enough to have two fundamental meetings in my life. One is with the Professor Gianfranco Sinigaglia, I4 BBE, that is one of the creators of the Northern Cross Radio Telescope. It's a transit radio telescope still in operation close to Bologna. It's a very big transit radio telescope. And I met him in the first years of my university, so in the 70s. And of course, the meeting with K1JT, Professor Joe Taylor, that I think you know very well, moved things a little bit far. I said, why only radio astronomy? Let's do pulsar radio astronomy. I don't want to embarrass myself too much because pulsar were described very well from other people and knows things much better than me. But just to recap, pulsar, it's the result, is the remnant of explosion of a special class of stars that collapsed into an object that is in the range of 20 kilometers of diameter. So very, very, very dense material, very high magnetic field and very high electromagnetic field, together with the fact that thanks to the conservation of angular momentum, those things spins at very high speed. Yesterday we have seen that the speed that the spinning is, can be from few milliseconds to seconds. All those things together, combined together, makes this object, this fantastic, this beautiful object, a kind of cosmic beacons. Because this configuration makes the emission of two noise cones rotating together with the pulsar, with this object. So the pulsar does not emit a single frequency like, for example, hydrogen or maser, as we have seen yesterday, but emit a very large spectrum of frequency, basically emit noise. Somebody had been asked, what is the frequency of pulsar? I said, no, it's not a frequency, it's noise. It's a very, very wide band noise. The more noise we can catch, the better. And so if we are lucky enough to be in the direction of these cosmic beacons, we can try to detect them. But there is a but, of course. The pulsar, the signal of the noise of the pulsar is very, 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 very weak. Let me make an example that can give you an idea how weak is this thing. I'm pretty sure that there are people in their organization and knows things much better than me, but I try to make this exercise. I think it's very interesting. Let's think to the EME path of moon bouncing. The attenuation, the loss on 1.3 gigahertz is about 270 dB. So every 3 dB, the power is divided by 2. This means that if you have a walkie-talkie transmitting 1 watt of effective irradiated power to the moon, we have a signal back at minus 240 dB. So basically undetectable. We cannot detect this kind of signal. Well, this minus 240 dB can be made similar to a unit of measure used for radio astronomy, that is for Jansky, we have seen yesterday, is 3000 Jansky over a 3 kilohertz bandwidth. So one walkie-talkie transmitting a signal to the moon and receiving back can have an effect of the signal on the Earth of 3000 Jansky. Well, the strongest pulsar at 1.5 gigahertz has a flow or intensity or whatever you want to call, or a little bit above 1 Jansky. So you can imagine how difficult is it. And the majority of the pulsar, of course, is in the range of milli-Jansky. So very, very difficult. And just put here the definition of 1 Jansky is 10 to the minus 26. Watt per square meter per hertz. This minus 26 gives you an idea of how weak is the signal of the noise of the pulsar. So pulsar are almost murmuring, and so I decided to call the program Murmur. Murmur, by the way, is an English word, but it's also coming from Latin, and also in Italian we have a similar word called mormorio. So that's the origin of the name of the program. with amateur equipment, with even with dishes pretty big, like 10 meters, 5, 10 meters, is until today, it's almost impossible to detect pulsar in real time. So the technique is to record the signal, the noise that you can receive, and then make a numerical analysis like with dedicated software, like for example, Presto, that has been described very well from Peter yesterday. And the technique is actually is to take the big file that you record over hours of recording, then you cut in block this big recording, and actually the block must be in the range of the period of the pulsar, and just you put one block on top of the other numerically. I think that graphically this thing is much easier to understand. This is the recording on the left, basically. Then you cut this big recording in small blocks, and just you put one block numerically on top of the other. It's like having a long piece of paper and just bending this thing. So what happens is that the noise that is random is tend to be eliminated, or because it's not summing up, because it's random. While the pulse of the pulsar that is not random is there every time, is increasing for every sum that we do. And this technique at the end that is performed, this technique that is used from all the program available from for pulsar detection, and especially from Presto that described yesterday, at the end gives this result that yesterday we have seen. This is a Presto plot of the B0329 plus 54, that is the strongest pulsar that we have received my dish at 400 megahertz. Here you have some technical detail, and on the right side you can see the best pulse. Actually, on my website where I have more, you can also find the program that actually using the output of Presto can show you the best pulse that you received. How we can predict this? When I started, I said I want to receive pulse. I said, how can I predict if my system is able to detect pulsar? Well, I mean, there is a very famous equation called radiometer, modified radiometer equation, that actually you can find in many books, but the things that I'm reporting here is exactly the radiometer equation on the Bible of pulsar reception, that is Handbook for Pulsar Astronomy from Duncan Lorimer and Kramer. This equation, if you put the numbers in this equation, you actually get the minimum detectable signal from your system, and then you compare this thing with the data, with the pulsar under analysis, and you say, okay, my minimum detectable signal is in the range of this pulsar, so I may be able to do that. So, but if you want to do that every time you want to detect the pulsar, it's pretty difficult. So I decided to write a program, Murmur, that can solve this thing automatically. The program is written in C++. It's actually C++ Embarcadero plus some other software to make the graph a little bit better. The program, as I was mentioning, is available for free from my website, that is i0naaaltervista.org, run under Windows, and comes with an installer. So you just download one thing, you click on this, and the installer creates a directory that you can, of course, change, and put in this directory all the support files that helps the program running. Murmur doesn't touch and doesn't use any Windows register, nothing. So you can remove the Murmur with the simple Windows uninstaller. The only things left will be the directory that you can remove manually. Before any release, I checked the program with Kaspersky antivirus, of course, and I keep constant attention to this because I want to avoid any problem with viruses. One thing that I need to tell you is that the program actually connects to the internet in two possible cases. When you want to see if you got the latest version of Murmur, when you hit the button check for updates, the program goes on internet, goes on my website, compare the latest release with the release that you have on the PC, and tells you if you have the latest version or not. And also, and we will see this later on, when you want to calculate, to estimate the noise Y factor. I'm telling this to you because somebody say, I cannot use your program because he wants to go on the web. Actually, yes, if you want to avoid this, just doesn't check, don't make check updates or don't calculate. But this is the only possibility for the program to go on the web. To go on the web. There are two modes for this program. One is pulsar mode, and this is the mode that we are going to discuss later on. And another one is the system evaluation mode. As you will see, this program is able also to give you a lot of information on your system. So somebody asked me, I'm not interested in radio astronomy. Can you tailor the program for me? And I did that. And so the program in system evaluation mode is a kind of kernel of the total program, with the addition that can explore all the frequencies. While in pulsar evaluation mode, I just explore the two frequencies, the 400 megahertz and the 1.4 megahertz, 1.4 gigahertz band. And of course, when Murmur is in system evaluation mode, I just take in consideration bandwidth, and I don't take in consideration the length of the recording or the integration bandwidth, because it does not make any sense. When you start the first time Murmur, the first thing that is asked you is where you are. Where are you? So you can enter your location many different ways. Here you can see, you can use sexagesimal notation, decimal location, or much easier, you can use your QRL locator. The program accepts the 8-digit QRL locator, so can be very, very precise in localizing you. Then you can save many more than one location, so you can use to analyze also some friend location or if you are moving some secondary location. The program automatically detects the area where you are and automatically detect if you are in DST time. So you will see, and we will see as soon as in the next slide, the time, the date, and so on that are taken from the computer and automatically calculated. There are two inputs, two possibilities. You can tell to the system, well, I have a dish antenna of 5 meters or whatever, or I have other antenna, and then you enter just the gain of the antenna. This is the first screen that you have after setting the location. Here on the left side, let me comment a little bit on the numbers that you can see that are your input to the system. This is exactly the picture of my system. I have a 5 meter dish. Usually for pulsar reception, I use 1303 megahertz, 1.3 gigahertz frequency. I just put 0.1 dB of loss before the low noise amplifier. This is estimated, but you know, should be okay. My LNA is just mounted on the feeder. I have an LNA with 0.23 dB noise figure and 38 dB of gain. And those two parameters were measured with my HP noise analyzer. And after that, I just put 0.5 line loss after the LNA, but this does not make any impact. Playing with this, you will realize that, you know, the impact after the preamplifier is really minimum. And also the same is for the receiver noise figure. So if this is good, all the rest can be low level. Then there are two parameters actually very important, the T sky and the spillover, the temperature of the spillover. The temperature of the sky must be entered manually. At 1.3 gigahertz, usually 4 degrees is quite good, unless you are pointing the antenna towards an area that got higher temperature, but this need to be careful. So this, and I will tell you later on how I hope to get rid of this problem of entering this thing manually. And the spillover is the temperature that the antenna, especially a dish antenna, is capturing due to the fact that the feeder is over illuminating usually the dish, and so taking some noise from the ground. Usually this thing of the spillover increase when the antenna, in the case of my dish, is up to the sky. Then entering all the, and of course you need to say, okay, I want to make recording for, I don't know, 3,600 seconds, 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, or whatever. And I have an integration bandwidth of 56 megahertz. In my case, I have my receiver got 56 megahertz bandwidth. I'm using a B200 Etus receiver with the software designed from I1 NDP, an Italian guy, to generate filter bank. Here on the left, on the right side, actually you can start seeing the derived parameters. If you hit the small button called I, that is stand for information, you will see how I calculated this number. I think that this is pretty important because first was for myself, because I wanted to be sure that I didn't make any big mistakes. So I just reported where I took the formula that I'm using. Example, the effective antenna aperture is calculated following the Krauss, the famous Krauss, the other Bible of radio astronomy, and the formula is reported over there. Then I calculate the far field we were discussing yesterday. The far field is not very useful for pulsar itself, but you know, tells you that in this area you can get noise much easier due to induction instead of radiation. So it's something that they say, okay, with my antenna it's better to have all the possible noise sources well far away, more far away than 200 meters. Then I calculate the antenna gain. In my case, my antenna is 35 dB. The angle of the antenna, I have about 3 degree antenna, 3 degree HBW. So if it is more, I drop more than 3 dB on each side. And then I calculate the system temperature in Kelvin, or in a way that for ham radio operator is much more familiar, in dB. Also, I calculate the GT ratio that is sometimes very useful in comparing radio telescopes. And then I go to noise floor, and last but not least, I go to minimum detectable signal. And this is the key things that I compare then, and we will see later on, with the data of the pulsar. And then, of course, all those numbers are mathematical, physical. And then there is some magic, let me say this, because there is the dish efficiency. Dish efficiency, no. Nobody will tell you how to calculate. Normally is put above the 50%. At the very beginning, I was putting 50%. When I achieved 50%, I stretched the things in order to be able to fine tune my setup as much as possible. And I put the 69 that I'm using all the time. And you will see later on why I'm using this. Hitting calculate, the system taking all those numbers tells you what are the pulsar that you are, you know, theoretically able to detect. How I'm doing this? I'm doing this because internal to the murmur, I have the database derived from ATNF, the Australian database for pulsars. And here you can see the version of the catalog. In this case is 1.64, I think it's still the latest version. And also the system tells you that in the database, he got 1,800 pulsar with the flow greater than zero at 1.4 gigahertz, and 663 pulsar with flow greater than zero at 400 megahertz. This list is derived imposing an expected signal to noise. The signal to noise that is used in the, with the pulsar is not the signal to noise normally used from amateur radio that is in dB, but is much, much, much more difficult to achieve because it's linear. Usually I put a signal to noise of 10, the higher the better, of course, but below 10, if you switch this number, you can also have a potential detectable pulsar higher number, but the probability to detect is much, much lower. So forget about, I would say, even if greater than 10 is difficult. Bear in mind that it's a theoretical number because this thing, of course, is not taking in consideration scintillation, because this is not predictable easily. And of course, does not take in consideration that, as we have seen yesterday, sometimes we are obliged to cut channels or to cut frequencies or to cut timing because you have a radar, you have somebody switching on a pulsar LED or somebody talking with the walkie-talkie on whatever. So, this is really the best case. That means that hopefully you have trying to achieve a signal to noise much, much higher. How can you achieve a signal to noise higher? Increasing the duration of the registration and increasing the bandwidth. Of course, usually you can do that. Usually I started with 2 megahertz with the RTL SDR. And then I migrated to the AirSpy 10 megahertz. Now I'm pretty happy with my 56 megahertz. But now my biggest problem is RFI that I'm trying to combat with the software that we have seen yesterday, with the software that Wolfgang was suggesting, RF Clean. But also I'm in cooperation with I1NDP. We are trying to put together our own program for RFI mitigation. We are achieving some results that we are not releasing yet, but we are pretty optimistic. So then if you click on the pulsar list, example, I clicked here on a B0329 plus 64, that is the bright star of our hemisphere. On the right side, you have all the most important parameters of the pulsar that are derived again from internal database, that is the ATNF. The pulse width, how wide this is the width, the wider the better because there is more energy associated. The bicentric period, so the period of the spinning, in this case, the 0329 is 0.7 seconds. The dispersion measure, yesterday Wolfgang explained to us very, very well the dispersion measure that actually is a parameter connected to the distance of the pulsar because the signal need to go through the interstellar medium. The flux, in this case, you see 1.5 Jansky at 400 megahertz and 0.2 Jansky at 1,400 megahertz. The distance, that is pretty interesting thing. This B03239 is 5,000 light years from us, of course, internal to our galaxy. The age of the pulsar, and here you can see how the age is calculated with all the formula, hitting the I button. The maximum integration bandwidth in the case you do not make the dispersion. The dispersion was again explained to us yesterday from Wolfgang. If you make the dispersion, you don't care. The wider the signal you receive, the better, but you need to take in consideration that you need to rotate all the signal. If you don't want to do that, you are unable to do that, then you need to limit your bandwidth. And here you have the number that is limiting this parameter. And then you have also information about the expected signal to noise that in this case it was 280. Very good, because the probability to detect this one is very, very high. In fact, I mean, this is something that you can detect even with antennas much, much smaller than a 5 meter dish. there is the friend called Andrea Dell'Immagine, and is detecting this with a corner reflector fixed antenna without tracking the pulsar. If you hit the button on top of this scheme, this button here, track noise sources, then you activate automatically a small widget. You can also hide my screen, and then you can move this widget on the screen, and you have the real-time tracking. You will see the numbers changing, so you will have azimuth and elevation of the moon, of the sun, of the Cygnus A, Taurus, Cassiopeia, Sagittarius, the Quasar 3C 273 that I'm still hunting, but I think that I was able to detect, but still I'm not convinced by that reason why it's there, because I'm still hunting for this. The magnetar that sometime is a magnetar, this one, sometime is really unpredictable because it's really pumping very, very, very strong, and the signal is much higher than the signal in quiet status. The Virgo A, of course, this is the picture of the black hole that that we have seen a couple of years ago. And you have the tracking, the automatic tracking of the pulsar that you clicked on the main screen. Again, I usually click this one, I make hide main screen, and then I go EME and I just survey the position of the other things and say, okay, it's time to stop EME. Let's try to make some radio astronomy, or vice versa. Very, you know, it's not consuming any CPU utilization and so on. How do I track those things? I track with an algorithm that was made available from Joe Taylor inside his famous WSJT program. Inside there is the routine. I took this routine. So the precision of this routine created by Joe Taylor is very, very high. So the numbers that you see there are very, 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 very precise. There are a few more things that you can do. You can see the visibility of the pulsar for the next 24 hours or for the next month, or you can also see the tracking. The visibility is when the pulsar is above the horizon. The tracking is wherever is the pulsar. And also you can hitting the button combination, you can see the combination of the object that you have seen on the small widget that actually tells you the tracking. But how can you be sure that your station is set up properly? There is one way, and this way is to measure all the elements, but the way that I like more is to measure the noise of few noise sources. And so I'm going to describe another things that is, I think, very useful from MoreMore test program on top of tracking the pulsars, or trying to detect the pulsar, but you know, it's trying to detect how much is the noise that you can detect from selected the noise sources. There are other programs able to do that, and I want to mention the EME planner from DAG, the DK3UM, that is unfortunately SK, silent key. So he's passed away a few years ago. He produced an excellent set of programs, and I was inspired from those programs. And actually, I produced this thing that is a little bit easier to manage compared to his program that remained for me a kind of guidance. So on the left side, you can see the noise, the flux in Jemski, that the most strong sources are emitting, and you can see the strongest one, of course, is the sun. But while all the sources are almost stable, you can see changing the frequency, of course, the signal strength, the flux changes, but the source is still is always the same. For the sun, the situation is totally different, because between quiet sun and active sun, there is a huge difference. So the mistakes that you can make thinking that the sun is quiet while it's active, or vice versa, can result in few dB, in several dB of mistakes, actually of errors. How we measure the sun noise or the whatever is a so-called Y factor, cold sky and then going to the to the noise sources. I use a program that you can also download from my website. It's called Total Power. It's a program that uses a very low, you know very well, the RTL SDR. Of course, with the limit of the RTL SDR, but it's very, you know, very valid SDR. That in conjunction to my Total Power program allows you to measure sun, moon, Cassiopeia, and so on. You can download again from my website, and after summer you will see an article on this on a pretty famous European magazine. And also this program is used from many, many people. And it's very useful, even with the limitation of our RTL SDR. So how, I mean, I can predict the noise of the sun? Actually, just hitting the calculate the noise Y factor on the main screen of the program, you activate the screen that you see here on the left. And then you need to hit download latest sun flow data and calculate sun noise. Actually, there is NOAA, the organization actually that is publishing the sun flux data at certain frequency continuously. Or, I mean, all every day at at different hours from different observatories. Actually, we have also one in Italy, it's called San Vito. And this website published the sun flow data continuously. But of course, this thing published the sun flow data at some predefined frequencies, 245 megahertz, 410 megahertz, 1.4 megahertz, and so on. So I decided to make a quadratic spline interpolation of this of those values. Based on the frequency that that you set in the main screen. So the program detects what is the best set, and the best set is defined as the set that got most data, make a cubic quadratic spline interpolation of the data, and then he tells you, well, the sun flow at 1.3 gigahertz, you remember that my frequency of that I'm using is 1.3 gigahertz, is this number here, 620,744 Jansky, calculated as quadratic spline interpolation, and the sun noise that you should measure is 19.22 decibel. Then you measure with Total Power or with another program the noise that you measure from the sun, and you hit save, and then this number goes on an internal database. In this database, you can the system automatically record the date, the temperature, the system temperature, the expected noise, and the measured noise together with the delta. You can also save all this database, and it's very useful because actually this is very interesting because after, you know, a few years of exercise, you see if your system is performing properly or not. And actually then you can make whatever you want as as analysis of the data. And here on the left side, you can see the solar flux data from 2018 going up to beginning of June. And as you can see, the sun flow is increasing. And ham radio community is very, very happy because this means that propagation is going to be better. Of course, we know from a radio astronomy point of view means that the sun will send more noise. So not very happy on the other side. And on the right side of this graph, actually, you see the expected noise and the measured noise. So you can see if the performance of your system is increasing, it's deteriorating, and so on. Here you can see that actually that my measured noise was not rising very well, despite the fact that the expected noise was rising. So, and this was due to a deterioration of the cable that is just in the beginning of June, and now it's much better. This is a very good tool to track your system. If you hit another button that call show Y factor for all noise sources, then you have another interesting information about the noise that you can expect from Cassiopeia, from Cygnus, from Taurus, Virgo, and from the Quasar, with the same quadratic interspline interpolation for the frequency. The reference that I used to calculate this are reported here. And also I made an exercise to predict the noise from the moon. I can easily see the noise of the moon when my antenna is in the range of 0.4 dB with a 5 meter dish at 1.3 gigahertz. But I said, but the moon is not a stable source because of illumination distance and so on. So I designed an algorithm that takes in consideration moon distance, moon age, because this is connected to the moon estimated surface temperature. And so I say, okay, the noise Y factor that you should receive is, in this case, was 0.39. Honestly, I follow actually the information of this those papers that you can see here on the bottom side of my foil. I'm not very happy with this. I still found some discrepancies. So while the other are very accurate, I would say, the moon still I'm struggling. You know, any suggestion to improve this will be very much appreciated. Then actually going back to the main program, actually you can, there are-
Mario, yes? one second here. Wolfgang's got a comment.
Okay, I don't see actually.
Wolfgang, go ahead.
Okay, go ahead, Wolfgang.
I need to unmute myself. Okay, just a quick comment on the, flux values that you have for Cassiopeia, yes, R and Cygnus A. I've seen something like 2,400 Jansky for Cass A. Yes. This is a outdated number, which is pretty old. And it's the Cassiopeia is declining. And we're probably now, I only have the number in my head at 1,400, but that's not too far off, is in around the 1,500 Jansky. Okay. I know that there are many people quote this 2000 something, which unfortunately is no longer correct. And another comment is on Cygnus A. There's an issue with Cygnus. The number for Cygnus A is probably correct for 1300 because that's very stable. However, if you use a smaller dish like a 3 meter or a 5 meter, the problem is that when you direct towards Cygnus, you're not only getting Cygnus A, but you're also getting other parts of the Cygnus complex. And that has to be taken into account. The funny thing is, if you take our 25 meter dish and look at Cygnus A and at Cassiopeia A is a bit stronger than Cygnus A as expected. But if I look at it with the 3 meter dish, it's just the other way around because I'm not only seeing Cygnus A and other sources as well. So one has to be careful with Cygnus because it depends on your resolution and the size of antenna because it's confusing different sources. We can discuss this offline in more detail, but just want to make that comment.
Thank you, Wolfgang. Very much appreciated. I knew about Cassiopeia. This one I knew, but I didn't find any evidence of this. I read this, but I didn't find any evidence of this. And on Cygnus A, actually, I suspected this because if you actually, I think that I show you during one direct lunge, my map of with my dish, I can see the two spots of the Cygnus A, but of course the I'm integrating two signals together. So maybe you can help me in refining those two. How about the Taurus, Virgo, and the Moon? Actually, that is my, you know, I'm not very happy with that. But
I mean, basically Taurus A and Virgo A and 3C, 2323, and so on. They should be very accurate. I mean, if you look at the data in the literature, that's unchanged, and according to what we measure, that's still the same. The moon, I don't have very much experience. I don't know how much that varies. There's some variation, obviously, but I have no good idea how that changes.
My algorithm actually is not giving a lot of variation. Of course, it is giving a variation, especially distance, but even temperature. But I'm not sure that my algorithm is there. I will appreciate your help, both Ganga, to refine this thing. Thanks a lot for your comment.
Let's take this offline because we have time for that.
Vielen Dank. Grazie. Really, really appreciated. Okay, so going to the other thing that I was discussing, actually you can sort the list of the pulsar by name, by right accession, declination, and so on. Usually I am sorting by expected signal to noise. Why? Because of course this gives to me the possibility to say, okay, I want to try to receive this one. And then I hitting the show of pulsar list, I have the list of all the parameters as per 18F catalog. Then I need to cover one thing that was covered before, but I think it's very, very important. It is the radio horizon. I think that Charles was mentioning this. Actually, let me skip to this, the next slide. This is my radio horizon, basically. What I did, I make a noise map moving 3 degree steps, my antenna at 1.3 gigahertz, and measuring the noise, and then integrating everything with MATLAB, basically. And you can see here that the noise I have is strictly related, of course, obvious, but when you see numbers, it's much more important, with the direction. Here is my observing site. Here you can see the antenna in the sleeping position. The north is there, and as you can see, I have the house and the trees. And here on the noise map, actually, you can see exactly this in the radio frequency, not only on the visual, but also on the radio. And what is telling me this thing? That I need to be above 20, 25 degree of elevation if I want to avoid the noise of ground. And the best chance I have is between, I would say, 60 degree and 200 degree. That is the quiet area. How do I use this information that, again, it's very important to map for a radio telescope? I use this information putting into the radio horizon here. Here I define the radio horizon by 30 degree, can be finer, but you know, for me, I found that is pretty satisfactory. And then I tell to the program, please give me visibility. So to plan observation. So the murmur automatically mask, like the RF mask that we have seen with Peter, all the position of the object that are below or that are covered from this mask. So here I can see for every object the visibility in azimuth and elevation. And so I can decide very well what are the observations that I want to make that day. And here on the left, you can also see a free column where I put okay. That means I detected this and so on. And so I can record this thing. So again, this is a very useful planning system, especially if you have an horizon that is not free, like in my case. Also, you can hit tracking planner, and then you can have for the next days the visibility of all the objects that are also on the tracking widget. And even if interesting is the drift scan planner. Yesterday, Wolfgang showed to us the drift scan of a quasar. Actually, it's something that I'm trying to do. And instead of calculating manually every time the things, if I just hit a drift scan planner, the system tells me, okay, if you want to wait for drift scan of the moon and want to be there 40 minutes ahead, go point the antenna 261 degree, 45 elevation, and just wait and see. Very useful. Of course, you can do that manually, but it's very, also very, very useful thing. Last but not least is the possibility of Murmur to cooperate with a program that I think few of you know very well, that is PST Rotator, is a program from Kodut Buta, YO3 DMU. This is a very interesting program that can drive almost all the commercial rotators. So that means that the program PST Rotator talks with your rotation system, and in parallel, as you can see, you can activate the function Murmur. So the PST Rotator take the direction to point from my program. So what I do normally is I say, okay, I want to track 3C2713, then I said, okay, select object to track. I have this object on the small screen here, and a small widget, and then I hit the tracking on the PST Rotator, and that's it. And I do the same for the pulsar, for the sun, for the moon, for whatever. Also, the other program, Total Power, is able to talk with the PST Rotator and make automatically the map of some area of the sky. If you download this program, of course, you need to accept this disclaimer. Unfortunately, you know, internet is a wide world, so means as a matter of fact, this program can drive your antenna, so you need to accept this disclaimer. I put most of my attention to this, but, you know, it's better that I avoid somebody suing me in the future, not you, of course, but this program has been downloaded more than 700 times. I have no idea whoever is using this in conjunction with the PST Rotator, and what is look like the future. Well, this program is very stable, I need to say. It's very, very stable. It runs smoothly on basically all the system, on the Windows system. I had feedback from many, many people that are happy with that. I didn't find any big bug yet. Whatever you find, please tell me, and I will, as Wolfgang suggested, very interesting comment, just drop me a note. I will be more than happy to correct. And of course, if you would like me to add some other function, I will be very glad to do that. What are the things that I have in mind? I want to add the background sky temperature, like what Jim Sky got on his fabulous program. So to avoid to put manually the temperature of the sky. Improvement in moon noise prediction, I was mentioning before, and now of course even improvement on the Cassiopeia and on Cygnus. I want to make automatic update of the pulsar database. Anyway, every time ATNF actually correct make a new version, usually I put the new version so it's automatically, but in the help function, you can also learn how to do that yourself. And I want also to improve the gain prediction of the dish, taking in consideration the mesh and some other parameter. The VK3UM EME planner is already doing this. My program is more basic, more rough. That's all. Grazie, that means thanks. Vielen Dank that Wolfgang is with us. And so I need to tell also in German. And this one only Wolfgang will understand. Ich habe fertig, Wolfgang. This is a joke.
that's probably a joke that only the two of us understand.
Yes, it's a joke. Back with the German language, and that's my presentation.
Thanks very much. Just for the benefit of everything, there is a famous interview with a soccer trainer who's of Italian origin, and he was really mad and he was complaining about things. And his last sentence was, ich habe fertig, which means I am ready, but it's so funny because it's a mixture between Italian and German. Funny story, I just only can laugh. I have one program which does spectral observation, and when it's done, it says, ich habe fertig.
Okay. David Westman has a question about your QRA. Go ahead, David.
Yes, I was looking up QRM locator in Wikipedia, and I noticed that it is actually declared obsolete and deprecated, and that you should be using the main temp locator. And I'm wondering if you actually are using that new locator, or if this change will be made to your program.
Sorry, I can't hear you very well. Can you repeat the question? Rich, can you summarize maybe?
I'll try it. He says he looked up the QRA locator, and it's supposedly obsolete now, and he's wondering if you're using the new version of Maidenhead locator.
You can use the 6-digit and 8-digit, both. The program should make no difference between the two. Actually, I'm not making any difference between the two. So,
So I guess there's a question about whether the quote the QRA locator is obsolete or not, and whether it's being updated. And then...
obsolete. What does it mean obsolete? Actually, this is there are many. I mean, for ham radio, the QRA locator is something that we are using all the day. With the 6-digit, is not very.
Well, there's some confusion about the term QRA locator. It's apparently still being used for the new mainnet locator, which supplanted the old QRA locator that was declared obsolete. So you should really check your terminology here, because it's apparently caused some confusion between the old QRA locator and the new one.
Okay, I'm not able to answer to this. Actually, something that maybe, the reason why I did the possibility that I get the possibility to enter the location with sexagesimal, decimal, and also with QRA locator, because this was not for ham radio operator, and only ham radio operator use this so-called QRA locator. So you can enter with the standard coordinates given from your GPS, and works perfectly. So Actually I'm doing this because I have a GPSDO for all the operation, and the GPSDO actually is giving to me very precise coordinates.
Okay. I do have a personal question about this. One of my primary questions I've tried to do with the radiometer equation is figure out how long I need to observe in order to get the right number of folds to detect the pulsar. And I was wondering, you've got that integration time. Is that the number that the system is recommending to observe?
No, actually, the integration time is a number that I give to the system. And I say, okay, I want to observe. This is depending from, it's connected to my radio horizon. Because from the planning observation, I know how long I can observe in a reliable way the source. So we say, okay, it's 3 hours. Then I put the 3 hours in the integration time. And so the system tells me, you know, if I have any chance it's not recommending. It's just I input this number and it's telling me, okay, Mario, no chance, or, you know, an S to N of 2, forget about, or even 11. When I see S to N of 50, then some good chance. So, it happened to me in the past, maybe a couple of years ago, that I was able to detect even with S to N of 15, 1.5. Now the situation is much, much worse due to radars. Yesterday, radar were not mentioned. When you observe for a long time, actually, the radar are terrible because they destroy totally channels. And, you know, the funny thing is that even with my antenna that is very precise, I mean, 3.5 degree of HP BW, I receive radar even, you know, if I look from the other side. As I think was Charles telling, if a signal can see the feeder, then you got the noise. The radar, you know, they use powers that are monster power. And I'm lucky. I'm located right in the center of Italy. My buddy, the I1 NDP, that is located close to the French border, is in a much worse position because he's taking all the radar from the French territory, from the Alps actually, so his noise is much, much, much worse. So the situation is degraded, so I need to increase basically the observation time, hoping that it's not going to affect much. And I'm using RF clean, Wolfgang, the thing that you suggested seems to be better, but you know, the experience with RF clean is still not good. And actually myself and Nando, we are trying to develop some on-the-fly system to reduce the noise. I don't know if we will be able to have something better or not, you know, but this is a good exercise to understand better.
And the other question is, you have that recommended bandwidth on the bottom of when you select a pulsar. Yeah. And is that, if I'm using a say 50 megahertz and you have a 16 megahertz in that recommended bandwidth, that means I should be reducing my bandwidth? Is that the way my observation?
No, not really. I think that you can see my screen, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm opening up the module. Okay. This is actually the things here that you can see here, the max integration bandwidth.
Right.
I think that you are referring to this.
That's
one. I think that is a little bit misleading, I need to admit, because this number actually, it's the maximum bandwidth without using the dispersion. But, you know, bottom line, we are always using the dispersion, because without using the dispersion, the probability to detect the pulsar is very, very low. So this is... you know, I was able to calculate, I put there, is not very useful. So it's not something that you should look at. Only if you said, okay, I don't know, you don't want to use the dispersion, but maybe it's a little bit misleading. So maybe I need to remove this. Thanks for the observation.
Oh, okay. All right, anybody else have any questions? There's a couple chat things about going on about the QRA and the main head. So you might look at the what the chat guys are doing. Let's see, any other questions for Mario? If you're into pulsars or just you want to characterize your system, he's got all the equations, even if you don't do pulsars. This is a very good program and very stable. I actually got the plus 54 pulsar by manually pointing it using Mario's azimuth and elevation numbers. And so I was able to point with 408 megahertz and get my first pulsar. So that's why I'm very happy with this program too. So it's very accurate. Okay.
Thank you.
All right.
I also discovered that it's used by Stanford Research Institute. You know, I got a message from SRI International. They are also using this. So I'm very happy of this. I'm very honored, to be honest. And I'm a semiconductor guy. I'm not a radio astronomer. So, you know, I might make some big mistake. Please correct me.
We're all good at something else besides radio astronomy. That's why we're in this society. Okay.
Hey, Rich, and with your superpower, can you, because I don't find any more stop sharing my screen. Can you just?
I can do that.
Okay, I got it. Okay, got it. Okay, got it. Fine.
Okay, everybody got everything? No more questions for Mario? All right. Oh. I got a lot of thumbs up. Ted Klein is the expert on Zoom. He gets that little thumbs up on reactions. So great job, Mario. Thank you very much.